Good afternoon. My name is Dr. David Nuttall. I'd like to outline some simple aspects of particle physics to help you with A-level studies. First of all, particles and antiparticles. Every particle has an antiparticle. Antiparticles are not constituents of normal matter. However, they are created when particles collide in high-energy accelerators, or when cosmic rays interact with matter, or during radioactive decay. A particle has the same mass as an antiparticle. A particle and its antiparticle have equal and opposite charge. An unstable particle and its antiparticle have the same lifetime. Now here are some particles and their antiparticles. An electron has an antiparticle of the positron, E minus and E plus, as you can see. Charge is minus 1, plus 1. Proton, antiproton, plus 1, minus 1. The antiparticles, as you can see, are denoted by having a bar over the top of them. So the antineutrino, for instance, is nu with a bar on top of it. Next, annihilation and pair production. If an electron and positron, or proton and antiproton, collide, they may annihilate each other. They cease to exist, and two, or perhaps three, gamma ray photons may be created in their place. Note, it is impossible for there to be just one photon. This would contravene energy and momentum conservation principles. In the case of annihilation, sufficient energy must be available for particles other than photons to be created. For example, an electron and positron with a sufficient energy in excess of 211.4 mega electron volts may annihilate to produce two muons. E minus plus E plus goes to mu minus and mu plus. At even higher energies, particles of even larger mass may be created. Notice that charge is conserved. In the case of pair production, this is a process in which a gamma ray photon ceases to exist, creating an electron positive positron pair in its place. In the bubble chamber photograph shown, gamma rays, tracks are not seen because they are uncharged, have entered from the left. In this event, on the right of the picture, a gamma ray photon has interacted with the nucleus of the bubble chamber liquid, creating an electron positron pair, as shown. Next, fundamental forces. There are four fundamental forces. Gravity. This acts on all particles and has an infinite range. Electromagnetic force acts between all charged particles. Because the electromagnetic force holds atoms and molecules together, it is responsible for almost everything that happens in everyday life. For example, buoyancy, friction and contact forces are all electromagnetic in origin. Weak interaction acts between all particles but over a very short range. Strong interaction or strong nuclear force holds nuclei together. And here's a table showing all four of them summarised. Notice that gravity, although we noticed it very strongly on Earth, is only very small compared with the other ones. The symbols are also shown. The photon is gamma, of course. The weak interaction forces are W plus, W minus and Z naught possibility. Gravitons have never been seen, but it's believed that particle exchange occurs between two masses. So when two particles A and B exert a force on each other, a virtual particle is created. This virtual particle can travel between A and B and affect their motion. An exchange particle is a virtual particle which may exist for only a short time and is what we call the mediator of a force. Exchange particles which are transferred between fundamental bodies, particles are called gauge bosons. Each fundamental force has its own boson or bosons. To try and simplify things, a famous American professor, Richard Feynman, developed a method to calculate rates for electromagnetic and weak interaction particle processes. So here you see him on a US postage stamp with his diagrams in the background. Simple rules for writing and interpreting Feynman diagrams. incident particles move up from the diagram from the bottom. A W boson transfers charge between particles and is shown as a wavy line. Left to right in the diagram represents time. A process begins on the left and ends on the right. And at any vertex, point where the three lines meet, represents an electromagnetic interaction. So here are two examples of Feynman diagrams. In figure A on the left, this represents an electric repulsion between two electrons and could be explained as one electron emits a photon and recoils, and the second electron absorbs the photon and acquires its momentum. Figure B represents beta minus decay. A neutron emits a virtual W minus boson and becomes a proton. The W minus then decays into an electron and an antineutrino, shown on the right. So here's a problem you might like to look at. The nucleus may capture an orbital electron, so converting a proton into a neutron with the emission of a neutrino, also known as K electron capture. And there's the equation 11p plus 0 minus 1e goes to 10 plus nu. So try and draw a suitable diagram to illustrate this effect. And there'll be a slight pause when you can have a go at doing this. Solution to the problem, electron capture. So the line on the left, P, goes in, wavy line W plus comes off it, and the neutron's created. And as we proceed to the right, electron comes in and the antineutrino goes off. Particle classification. A fundamental particle is one in which cannot be split up into something smaller. It has no internal structure or components. Current theory suggests that there are only three families of fundamental particles, namely leptons, quarks and gauge bosons. First of all, we'll look at leptons. Electrons, positrons, neutrinos and antineutrinos are all light particles called leptons. They have never been split into smaller particles and appear to be fundamental with no radius but rather point-like objects. All leptons interact by way of the weak interaction, however charged leptons can interact through the electromagnetic interaction. Here's a table showing electrons and muons and different leptons here, showing their charge. They're assigned a lepton number, Le, L mu or L tor, depending on the family they've come from, electron, muon or tor particles. Properties are all shown there in the table. Now we'll show the operation of the conservation law that lays down lepton numbers are conserved in all interactions. For example, the unstable mu minus particle decays as under. Mu minus goes to electron plus the new mu and new electron antiparticle. So first line, Le, that's naught. Anything associated with it, with the muon is naught. Le is 1 because electron is 1, and then naught, and then the new bar E is minus 1, so naught goes to naught. The L mu, that's 1 in that case, naught electron, 1 for the new and naught electron, so 1 goes to 1, and the L tor, naught, naught and naught, there's no tor there at all, so it's just naught. Hadrons interact by the way of strong, weak and electromagnetic interactions and are divided into two groups, baryons and mesons. Neutrons and protons have measurable radii and consist of smaller particles called quarks, Q. Baryons are composed of three quarks, antibaryons of three antiquarks. All baryons except the proton are unstable. All other baryons decay to protons, either directly or indirectly. Mesons composed of a quark and an antiquark. All mesons are unstable, decaying either directly or indirectly into photons or leptons. So now we have a table of hadrons. They're shown mesons at the top and baryons on the bottom with their charge, baryon number and strangeness. their mass as well, and typical decay modes, plus the antiparticles with them. Quarks and antiquarks. Quarks are fundamental particles and are the constituents of hadrons and cannot exist independently. The properties of each hadron can be explained in terms of the quarks that it contains. The total charge on a hadron is the sum of the quark charges. The same can be said for the total baryon number and strangeness. The proton is composed of two up quarks and a down quark, i.e. the proton is UUD, so we can predict the charge, baryon number and strangeness as shown below. Charge is plus a third, plus a third, plus a third, equals one. Baryon number is a third, which is one. And strangeness is naught, naught and naught, of course, throughout. Here's a table showing the details of down, up and strange quarks, together with anti-down, anti-up and anti-strange, with the baryon number, charge and strangeness. These can be used in solving problems involving whether it's possible for interactions to occur or not, as we'll see in a minute. The quark combination for mesons is shown in this diagram. Strangeness goes from minus 1, 0 to plus 1 at the top, and charge increases across from minus 0 to plus across the bottom. So for instance, the simple one is pi naught, which is UU bar or DD bar, so the charge is cancelled out, so that's got zero charge. The kaons at the top and bottom contain strangeness, either minus 1 or plus 1, and as you can see, simple arithmetic enables the overall charge to be found. The quark content of some particles, antiparticles, is shown there. Proton UUD, neutron UDD, and so forth, together with the antiparticle and its quark content. So, for instance, the antiproton would be U bar, U bar, D bar, and so forth. Conservation laws, we've mentioned this before, there are six things that need to be conserved: momentum, charge, mass energy, lepton number, baryon number and strangeness. Strangeness is the only one which has exceptions to it. Strangeness is conserved in all strong interactions and in all electromagnetic interactions. In weak interactions it changes by plus 1, minus 1 or 0. Production reactions, one in which two or more particles combine to form other particles, occur by way of the strong interaction, and therefore strangeness is conserved in all production reactions. So here's a worked example on conservation laws. First of all, A, which of the following reactions can occur? In the case of A, P plus P is equal to N plus P plus pi plus. That may seem not to balance, but we'll have a look at it. In the case of charge, plus 1 and plus 1 is on the left hand side, and neutron has no charge. Proton is plus 1 and pi is plus 1, so 2 equals 2. So that is possible from the charge point of view. From the baryon number, proton has 1, neutron is 1, so 2 equals 2. The pi plus has no baryon number, so 2 equals 2, so that's possible. And the strangeness is all 0, so that reaction is feasible. In the case of B, hopefully simple inspection would show that this is not feasible because of the charge. E plus plus E plus goes to mu plus and pi minus. So we have two positive charges on the left and we have zero charge on the right. So in the first equation it shows that's not feasible. And the baryon number and strangeness are just put there for completeness. So here's some simple questions that you might like to try. Solution to the answers for the previous problem. One cannot occur because it contravenes charge conservations and strangeness conservations. Obviously, the charge is the easiest one to see normally, but just to back it up, you can show the strangeness is not conserved. Number two cannot occur since it contravenes baryon number and strangeness conservation. And number three can occur. Thank you very much for listening. I hope this has been some help to you. And for extra information, please visit www.alevel-physics.co.uk. Thank you very much and good luck with your physics studies.